So, Josh, why are we here in the Brecon Beacons?
Why are we here? Because there aren't too many hills. There aren't too many hills in London. And in terms of training for the largest mountain in the world, I suppose you've got to get better, get some hills in. So, beautiful day, as you can see. Managed to retain and be reasonably dry so far. It's all good.
So you are going to go and climb Mount Everest?
That's the plan.
That's serious, isn't it?
Well, yeah, you've got to do a bit of training for it and stuff. But, April, May and June. So at the moment in the office, Monday to Friday. So get whatever training while Keith is in Afghanistan. Try and get some training in while we can, and that means weekends driving up to places like this.
Now, Keith is your climbing partner, and it's just going to be the two of you and a few Sherpas, is that right?
Yeah, well, we are going with a firm, but I think that when you do an event like that, you want to feel as though you've pulled your weight and carried your own oxygen and food, this and the other. So it's what they call a leaderless climb, and you need to be fairly proficient. Not necessarily you have to be Conrad Anchors of this world, but you need to be able to know what you're doing and look after yourself.
Now, for those who don't know, of course, you were in the army before you became a full-time professional rugby player and went on to win the Rugby World Cup. How stiff a challenge is this one for you?
Well, it's meant to be the hardest one. That's why we're doing it, and that's why people do it. Marcus, friends of both Keith and myself, I think that most people realise this, not just in terms of a metaphor, Everest is meant to be the ultimate challenge, and that's why we want to go and do it.
Now, let's not be at the back of the bush here, Josh. Everest is dangerous. You've done a few things in your time, but this, hopefully, everything will be fine. But it's life-threatening.
Yeah, if you make the wrong choices, or you get unlucky, yes. Which is why you train hard. They say you play easy, but there's certain factors outside your own control. I think you've got to go with good people, get as much experience as you can, and not make stupid decisions in charge of. Let get summit fever, or let your testosterone or your ego do the making decisions.
So with that in mind, do you have to summit, or do you just have to give it your best shot?
Well, it's like playing sport, isn't it? I mean, sometimes you can do everything possible within your control, and some things just don't go your way sometimes. And you've got to be able to look yourself in the mirror at the end of it and know that you've put everything into it. And I think that's the key. You probably have to ask me that question in a few months' time.
What do your friends and your family think of this?
My mum turned around once and said, "Josh, I'm not really very happy with this Everest thing." I think they know what I'm like, so my brothers haven't shown undue concern or worry, that's for sure.
I'm just wondering, Josh, obviously you left the army because you couldn't merge the army and the demands of professional rugby, plus I think I'm right in saying you felt as if you weren't doing the army justice, you felt as if you wanted to get out there and you couldn't. Is there a slight sort of a throwback to that, of putting yourself, pitching your wits up against the stiffest challenge?
Probably hit the nail on the head, in terms of probably a bit old now and missed too much to have, operational duties. And perhaps you're right, there is a bit of that. You've got to make choices in your life. And, the whole point about being a specialist at something is by specialising. By specialising, that means sacrificing, doing other things, and it was the hardest choice I ever had to make. I made the right choice because 12 months later we lifted the World Cup. But when I lifted the World Cup, this fella here and some of the other lads are out, doing the duty and fighting in Iraq and now in Afghanistan as well. So, everyone, you take your own path in life and you represent your country in different ways.
Now, a lot of people would assume because you were a rugby player, you must be fit, therefore this shouldn't be too difficult. Could you try and explain how, yes, you are fit, but there are specific fitness requirements for specific challenges.
Yeah, well, I mean, rugby is, and has been for the last, you know, I've played rugby for 28 years, actually, but since playing professionally, 12, 13 years ago, whatever, it's all power and speed, short, sharp, and you know, the game lasts 80 minutes. Mountaineer is an entirely different type of fitness, and I'm an entire novice, and it's just a case of endurance, just being used to go at a not necessarily fast, not a steady pace, 10 hours a day, regularly, every day. And actually, it's a completely different type of mentality. Teach yourself to slow down, not push yourself as hard as enough. So, fitness wise, yes, you've got a decent level of fitness, and mentally, you're used to pushing yourself, but it's about sort of holding yourself back sometimes and just being able to go for 10 hours a day on hills. That's why we're out here.
And you talked about being a novice. I guess you also need a degree of humility as well. It doesn't matter who you are, what you are, you're facing Everest, and I guess you're not the boss.
No, absolutely. Well, clearly, I think that, you know, one thing you realise is, you know, the other day, it's quite interesting, I got knocked off the bike the other day, and the car behind screeched to a halt, the wheels stopped just sort of a yard or so from my head, and realised that you could go like that, and you're not very important for it in the grand scheme of things. So when you're taking on something as monumental as Mount Everest, then clearly you need to be very, very respectful and a high level of self-preservation.
But that's the thing, you see, making it is not reaching the summit, is it?
No.
Making it is getting back to base camp.
It's interesting, you know, I think that's one of the hardest challenges, because, you know, making the right decisions is very important. And it was Shackleton who wrote to his wife, because obviously Scott made it to the pole and died, and Shackleton, sort of for the good of his men, turned round, and on the day he turned round, he wrote to his wife saying, I turned round today knowing that I'm a failure. However, I turned round on the thought that you would prefer a live ass than a dead lion. So interesting, it was a different mindset to Scott's. I think you're going to try and retain that in the back of your head.
Difficult question and a hypothetical question, but if you give it a stab, you've won a Rugby World Cup and a lot of other things in rugby. You've reached the absolute summit, if you excuse the pun, in rugby. Do you think if you were to get up to the top of Everest, or even just push yourself to the absolute limit and be satisfied with that, would that rank up there with anything you've achieved in your previous profession?
I think only hindsight would be able to answer that question. You know, something I've always wanted to do, and the reason why I stepped out of the sport earlier than I needed to, is because I wanted to take on, you know, for me, what I saw as the ultimate challenge before real life kicks in, before other responsibilities come along, and before your focus changes for delivering for others as opposed for achieving things for yourself. So ask me that in a few months' time. A, hopefully I'll be here to answer the question, and secondly, be a bit more equipped to do so.
Marcus, if he gets lucky and the weather's kind and the mountain's kind and everything goes his way, he'll do it, won't he?
Actually,